you can't write stories about aeroplanes. Stories are about people.
On Valentine's Day, 1949, a struggling middle-aged writer sat down to reinvent himself. As John Harris, he had written short stories for American magazines. In his new incarnation, he would go on to produce some of the most famous novels in British science fiction. The Day of the Triffids, The Chrysalids, The Midwich Cuckoos. Tales of biological engineering, genetic mutation, surrogate mothers, real science filtered through an extraordinary imagination. Today, these books give us a unique insight into the post-war years, but the author remains a mystery. So who really was John Wyndham?
A triffid is a large, lumbering,
malevolent and poisonous nettle.
It moves like a man on crutches. So it's got three legs and it sort of moves its front two legs and then drags its third leg behind.
It sounds more than it looks. That eerie kind of tock, tock, tock.
Sinister, I think, is the word I'd use. Rather sinister. You look at it and think, ooh.
The Day of the Triffids was John Wyndham's breakthrough novel. Since its publication in 1951, it has never been out of print. It is one of the definitive novels of the post-war decade.
How come this book sold millions for year after year? It's because there's something behind it that is attractive. Obviously, it was what people wanted in trumps.
Wyndham didn't often talk about his work. But in 1960, in his only ever TV interview, he revealed the inspiration for the book.
May I ask you, Mr. Wyndham, where it is that you rely upon, how it is you rely upon, and indeed what it is you rely upon for your stimulus?
Sometimes one gets an idea thrown at one. The original Triffids one, I think, came one night when I was walking along a dark lane in the country and the hedges were only just distinguishable against the sky. And the higher things sticking up from the hedges became rather menacing and felt that they might come over and strike down.
Out of this small seed grew a story which has been translated all around the world and adapted for radio, TV, and a Hollywood movie.
The Day of the Triffids.
The story begins with a mysterious meteor storm. Everyone wants to see the show, but on the following morning, all the eyewitnesses wake up blind.
What is it, Dr. Soames? What's happened?
The optic nerves are gone. The glare of the meteorites last night. You are probably one of the few people left in London who can still see this morning, Mason. I don't envy you.
As Wyndham's hero wanders through the streets of London, the world falls apart around him. Wyndham had lived through the Blitz and fought in the war. His descriptions of a destroyed London were authentically surreal.
A cat on the pavement was engaged in sniffing at something which might have been a bundle of rags, but was not. A man came around a corner. He had a gloating expression on his face and was perseveringly rolling a large cheese along the middle of the road. When he heard my step, he halted his cheese and sat on it, brandishing his stick fiercely.
Wyndham wasn't content just to destroy London and blind humanity. As the survivors come together, they're confronted by mankind's nemesis, the Triffids.
Stay here.
These huge, hungry plants make easy meat of the blind before turning on the survivors.
Come on, let's go down to my ship.
The Triffids look out of this world, but Wyndham was never just a fantasist. His genius was to root his bizarre creations in the real world. The Day of the Triffids tapped into a scientific debate which was raging in the late 40s. This was a period in which, all over the world, strange experiments were being carried out on plants. In America, scientists were exposing crops to radiation in order to create new mutant strains.
A lot of plant breeding at that time depended on using atomic energy to create mutations that would then grow and be useful. Nectarines, which we all know and like, a slight improvement on peaches in terms of the mouthfeel and quality and so on, are actually mutants that were derived by irradiating peaches with atomic energy, with atomic irradiation.
But the strangest work of all was going on behind the Iron Curtain. In the late 40s, Soviet agriculture was dominated by one man, Trofim Denisovich Lysenko, an archetypal mad scientist.
He was the barefoot professor, basically a farmer's son, and interested in plant breeding, but managed to get Stalin's eye, and his views were balmy, basically.
Long before anyone had heard of genetically modified crops, Lysenko was creating strange new hybrid plants. In the Soviet Union, he was hailed as a genius. In the West, no one was quite sure what to make of him.
This was a big debate in the newspapers at the time, was Soviet genetics. You had popular books like this coming out from the communist press at the time in Britain, but these were quite widely sold pamphlets called Lysenko is Right, exactly at the time that that Wyndham was writing The Day of the Triffids.
Wyndham mixed fact and fiction, name-checking Lysenko and identifying the Triffids as a Russian hybrid, unwittingly created as a food crop.
I teach a course on science and the media. One of the games that I play with that is to give students a section from Day of the Triffids and say, right, tell me when this was written. Because it's effectively a section of chapter 2, which is all about the making of the Triffids. And they say, oh, well, it's about Monsanto, or it's about genetically modified organisms. And I say, well, it was written in 1951. Don't think we knew what DNA was then.
Visually, Wyndham's Triffids resemble overgrown hothouse plants. There are hundreds of different types of carnivorous plant, and Wyndham seemed fascinated by them.
There are elements of Triffids in lots of other plants. I mean, some plants can move a little, but no plants can move, take their roots up and walk around. There are plants that eat animals, or insects at any rate. So there's a little tiny bit of Triffids in many other plants, which is why it's such a wonderful sort of synthesis. But an actual Triffid, no, not possible, I'm afraid.
For Wyndham, though, what if was always more interesting than exactly how. Reality was an inspiration, not a limitation. And anyway, this was not a story about plants. It was a story about people. People caught up in a catastrophe.
Can you help me, sir? Please,
someone
can you help
sees.
Me?
Beg pardon, sir. You help me
Excuse
up.
Excuse me, sir. I couldn't help overhearing.
If you could just tell me to a taxi.
If you could just make a telephone call for me to my wife.
I'd be happy
please.
To pay. Please help yourself to my purse.
I'm sorry. There are no taxis.
The second half of the book looks at what the survivors do next and reveals one of Wyndham's great influences, his school days. For 3 years, between 1918 and 1921, Wyndham attended Bedales in Hampshire. then as now, one of Britain's most radical schools.
It was essentially a rural school with a rural spirit of adventure, idealistic, optimistic community. Bedalians were trained not to be helpless, not to rely on servants, but to be the kind of people who could fix things. There is an anti-industrial, anti-urban feel about it.
Just as Bedales took the sons and daughters of the British middle class back to nature, so Wyndham took the survivors of his fictional catastrophe out of the cities and into the countryside. Ultimately, his hero ends up on the Isle of Wight, where an idealistic group of survivors has set up a self-sufficient community. It gave the book an optimistic ending, but for some readers, it was too much.
The central character gets a girlfriend, have choice of cars for free, free petrol, in the midst of all this chaos going on. I mean, this is a cozy catastrophe because things may be bad, but the hero is having a good time. And where does he end up? The Isle of Wight. Oh, I mean, how cozy can you get?
Cautionary tale or cosy catastrophe, whatever, The Triffids was an immediate success. For thousands of teenagers, Wyndham was their introduction to science fiction.
Triffids came out in 1951, I think. I probably read it a couple of years afterwards, when I was about 12 or 13. I was impressed and horrified by it as a story.
I remember reading it with great excitement. Very keen on the local library then. I used to cycle off every week and get my three books each week out of the local library. And all the kids I knew all knew about Triffids. You know, it was a playground name and so on, certainly.
At the age of 48, John Wyndham was hailed as the next big thing. But though he enjoyed the success, he didn't like the attention. Even to his friends, he was an enigma.
He never discussed his personal life. He never talked about his parents, his background. He was a detached sort of person. He liked being on the edge of things, part of the group, but not necessarily wanting to say too much. He was a quite good listener.
For his biographer, David Ketterer, Wyndham has been a real challenge.
He didn't want people to know much about what was going on in his life beyond what's on the back of those Penguin paperbacks. At the end of his life, somebody wanted to write a fairly detailed biography or add to what already existed, and he refused.
Only recently have the facts of his childhood begun to emerge. John Wyndham Parks Lucas Beynon Harris was born in Birmingham in 1903. He enjoyed a conventional middle-class life until the age of 8, when his parents separated amidst a scandal.
The most traumatic event in his life was the separation of his parents. That was when his world was destroyed, and that's the kind of the catastrophe, that's the back of the catastrophes in his fiction.
Wyndham's father was an author, a barrister, and a serial philanderer. After the separation, he was hardly seen again.
Was it alcohol, was it financial fiddling, or was it both? He didn't have constant contact with his father at all. In fact, his mother moved from hotel to hotel to try and avoid contact with her husband, because she had custody of the children.
Ironically, though, in 1924, Wyndham's mother sent him to Oxford to study law and follow in his father's footsteps. But by now, Wyndham had other interests. He was increasingly fascinated by science, Instead of mugging up for the bar, he spent his time reading science books and exploring Oxford's museums.
I don't think he had the mind for a lawyer because he was very much for fair play. And he seemed to get the opinion that lawyers did a little bit of twisting here and there on the behalf of their clients. And he was very upright, you know, very loyal. And he felt he couldn't go in for that sort of career.
Needless to say, he didn't become a lawyer, but nor did he become a scientist. Instead, he moved to London, where he tried to become a writer. He'd had a short story published whilst at Bedales, and in 1930, he had his first literary success.
Future flying fiction, $100. Thank you very much.
He won a competition to devise a slogan for an American science fiction magazine. Soon he was writing space stories for magazines such as Wonder Stories and Amazing Stories under the name of John Beynon Harris.
I do remember his as being definitely amongst the superior ones. He wrote better altogether than most of them. Poor chaps, they were writing for 1 cent a word. And so the more they could pad it, the better it was for them. They were working guys.
In the 1930s, science fiction was literally out of this world.
There, that should do it. I've settled on Flash's wavelength. Now I'll try to get him. Hello, Flash. Hello? Dr. Zarkov?
Sci-fi meant space cowboys gallivanting around far-off galaxies.
I remember once seeing a Flash Gordon film. He's being pursued by somebody. And it's my favourite line in science fiction. He opens up the boiler on his spacecraft and he shouts, "Throw on more uranium." It's obviously a steam-powered spacecraft.
Wyndham's literary ambitions were never going to be fulfilled writing pulp fiction. His hero was H.G. Wells, and he too wanted to write intelligent novels for the mass market. Success, though, would not come quickly. During the war, the writing stopped. In between the bombing raids, Wyndham's literary skills were diverted into first the civil service and then the Royal Corps of Signals. Lance Corporal Harris had a miserable war. And D-Mob was no better. Funds were short, and no one wanted his novels. Things got so desperate that he almost gave up.
He got a job for a time on an advertising firm writing ads, and he left it in disgust. He said, "Concocting lies. I'm not going to spend my writing ability and time concocting lies and manipulating language to get some housewife to buy this, that, and the other because it washes whiter than something else." He was very strong on that point.
To add insult to injury, his brother Vivian, an actor by trade, got a 3-book deal. As a final throw of the dice, he dug out a manuscript which he'd been working on for several years and changed the name on the cover to a new nom de plume, John Wyndham.
And this is the dream of every writer, that you put something on one side and then you pick it up a little while later and you go, "It's not half bad, you know, I've got something here." And he said that happened with the Triffids.
The international success of the Triffids took Wyndham totally by surprise, but he was quick to capitalise on it. His new style of earthbound science fiction found an eager audience in Britain, and there was plenty to write about. For anyone interested in science, this was an extraordinary period. Computers, robots, jet engines, electronics. It was a world of boffins and gadgets. The future seemed to be just around the corner.
There was a very much more positive spin on science than there is probably now. but then I think science was perceived as being a potential way out of the post-war period, the austerity, the problems of society. Science was going to help us into a new way of living.
But there was also a dark side to the period, which Wyndham's novels tapped into.
It was the early days of the Cold War. There was that sort of feeling about, you know, that catastrophe might be just around the corner.
As if to make the Cold War literal, the late 40s suffered one of the worst winters on record, and the 50s began with some of the worst floods. Wyndham's follow-up to the Triffids, The Crake and Wakes, took a bleak inspiration from the events. It was another catastrophe story featuring alien sea monsters which drown the world by melting the polar ice caps.
He has that brilliant imagination for the situations that he creates. So each one of the kind of his biggest novels has such a kind of clear catastrophe that takes place that you kind of think, how could nobody have thought that before? It's one of those sort of, you know, the kind of the plants coming alive or the beast under the sea and the world getting flooded, those sorts of things.
The big story of the decade was the bomb. Wyndham was fascinated by its implications. Here was the ultimate proof of the power of science and the ultimate proof of how dangerous it could be.
The early childhood of my first two children was blighted, is too strong a word, but it was overshadowed by this fear that we were going to be blotted out by nuclear war. It would be a 4-minute warning and then the Holocaust. So it was very reasonable for Wyndham to use this.
Like many contemporary scientists, Wyndham was intrigued by the long-term effects of nuclear fallout. Thousands had already died at Hiroshima and Nagasaki, but would life be even worse for the survivors?
After Hiroshima and Nagasaki, the first group of Americans into the city were a bunch of geneticists, because there was a strong belief that there would be dramatic effects, first of all upon the people who were irradiated, and that was certainly right. Large numbers of them died of radiation sickness. Many others got thyroid cancer, but more particularly on their offspring, on their children.
In 1955, Wyndham unveiled The Chrysalids, his bleak vision of life after a nuclear war. There were no cute illustrations on the Penguin cover, but inside, Wyndham's terse prose conjured up a strange world full of mutant plants and mutant people. There were two-headed calves, huge horses, telepathic children, and a strange sect which wanted to destroy all mutations.
It's a harsh book. It's about a group of young and innocent people who are victimized because they got one toe too many on their feet.
The Chrysalids is absolutely a book of its time. It was published in 1955, and this is 10 years after Hiroshima. In Japan, the Atomic Energy Commission is still looking for mutant babies in the first generation of post-Hiroshima survivors. The Cold War is heating up. A few years previously, the Soviets have exploded their first atomic bomb. Themes of global destruction, radiation, mutation, these are on lots of people's minds.
But Wyndham never gave his imagination absolutely free rein.
There was, in the original, a point where a man had, his hat was knocked off and he was seen to have a third eye in the top of his head. Well, there's no reason why he shouldn't have a third eye, but it just has an unpleasant taste.
So this was the limit of your lower depth.
On the whole, the story seemed pleasanter without it.
Jane Austen says somewhere, you know, let other pens dwell on horrors. I don't want to go that way. And I always felt that John didn't want to explore too deeply into the horror side of human nature.
His American publishers were always saying, look, you must put some explicit sex in, it won't sell if you don't. And he said, nonsense, I'm not going to give you an honest point. I want my books to be able to be read by anybody, and I'm going to put in just enough to start people's imagination working, if they're interested in that. But if they're not interested, then they won't be put out.
Look at those great, big, beautiful babes.
Hey, baby, you're really out of this world.
Wyndham's very English sense of good taste set him apart from American science fiction.
Invaders from Mars! Weird!
In the late 50s, Hollywood was obsessed with flying saucers and extraterrestrials. On both sides of the Atlantic, UFO fever was in full swing, and there were dozens of alleged sightings of unidentified flying objects. Wyndham had left space behind, but in the mid-50s, he too began to work on a UFO story with a very English twist. He did much of the writing at his best friend Biff Barker's house in the village of Steep, next to Bedales.
He was coming down a week at Christmas and a week at Easter, and then for about 4 or 5 weeks in the summer. He and Dad had long conversations over meals while we did the washing up, normal. And then he'd go off, do a bit of gardening in the morning, and then he'd after about half an hour or so, he'd go into where he was staying, either the front room or the second bedroom, and just shut himself in with his cigarettes and type away as hard as he could. And it was family honour not to disturb him for any reason whatsoever until mealtime came and Mummy would ring a bell and he'd come.
In September 1956, Wyndham heard some devastating news. Biff Barker's daughter was about to enter a convent.
The date was on his mind. He was very depressed for several weeks up to this date. Well, he didn't believe in organized religion and in religious worship, and the fact that my mother and myself both became Catholics, that I wanted to come to the Abbey and live a religious life was just he considered I was committing suicide. Just throwing my life away. I think he thought I'd had an unhappy love affair and this was just on the rebound. But of course, he was quite wrong.
Wyndham was so traumatised by the news that he was ill for weeks. But he carried on writing, and in 1957, he published his classic novel, The Midwich Cuckoos, a tale of strange goings-on in rural England. It was set in the fictitious village of Midwich, in the fictitious county of Wyndshire. It's a pocket of quintessential Englishness, a little bit like the real town of Midhurst, just down the road from the Barkers' cottage.
Good morning and welcome to Midhurst. Our topic is John Wyndham, specifically his book, The Midwich Cuckoos, and I leave it to you whether your readers of Wyndham who will be looking out to see if Midhurst is possibly this imaginary landscape.
He draws inspiration from this part of Sussex that he knew from the age of 15 and which he loved absolutely all of his life. He sets you up with how the roads work and how they connect to the other imaginary villages in this section of Wyndshire. And I think it is for control of the story.
Throughout his life, Wyndham was a huge fan of the Archers, and he makes Midwich seem as real as Ambridge.
The church is mostly perp and deck, but with a Norman west doorway and font. The vicarage is Georgian, the Grange Victorian. Kyle Manor has Tudor roots with numerous later graftings. Midwich has, or rather had, lived and drowsed upon its good soil in Arcadian undistinction for 1,000 years. And there seemed, until the late evening of September the 26th, no reason why it should not continue so to do for the next millennium too.
But then, time stands still. An unidentified flying object lands in the middle of the village, and everyone, men, women, cows and visitors alike, goes to sleep.
It's very much the Sleeping Beauty idea, that everyone falls asleep under an enchantment.
In Wyndham's twisted fairy tale, when the Sleeping Beauties awake, every woman of childbearing age is pregnant.
When he was writing the Midwich Cuckoos, he wasn't sure whether he wasn't perpetrating a big dirty joke, as he called it. You know, all these women in the village of Midwich, after all, get penetrated by aliens. And so he was very nervous about this.
9 months later, 61 babies are born. They all look perfectly normal, except for two tiny details.
The only physical difference is the golden eyes. But for that reason, there's that sort of constant question about, you know, are they different? What are they thinking? If it's monster-shaped, you know how scary it is.
These aliens really are cuckoos in the sense that they're parasites, they're exploiting the human hosts to raise their own offspring, exactly like the cuckoo bird exploits the warbler hosts. And then the cuckoo chick manipulates the hosts again with this fantastic rapid begging sound, which sounds like a whole brood of chicks. So even though the host might see what to them looks like an alien chick, this manipulative sound gears them against their best interests to carry on caring for the cuckoo chick. And it's very similar in Wyndham's cuckoos, these golden-eyed children manipulating the women into staying at the village, apparently against their wishes.
Like the reed warblers of the natural world, the surrogate mothers of Midwich find themselves strangely drawn to their alien babies.
There's these beautiful, healthy babies with their golden eyes and they're blonde and they look pretty lovable, and that's what the mothers do.
For the men, it's different. The central character of the book is Gordon Zellaby, a writer and philosopher who lives in Midwich. His daughter is one of the surrogate mothers.
He's a philosopher, he's a sociologist. He doesn't appear to have any kind of academic job that would require him to teach or occasionally to be specific about points. He sits and he writes accounts of the state of British society today, or the state of British morals, or the state of British politics. I think he's what Wyndham most fears he is like.
Wyndham gives Zellaby all the book's rhetorical speeches. He is the first to recognise just how dangerous the cuckoos are.
Zellaby continued, "The important thing about the cuckoo is not how the real egg got into the nest, nor why that nest was chosen. The real matter for concern comes after it has been hatched, what in fact it will attempt to do next. And that, whatever it may be, will be motivated by its instinct for survival, an instinct characterized chiefly by utter ruthlessness."
When the cuckoo children grow up, they move into the Grange, a government building which they use as a school and dormitory.
Sir B.
Gordon Zellaby is one of their teachers. He is the first to realise that the children have special powers.
N equals B.
E. Teach one boy algebra, and they all know it. Teach one girl geography.
With the telepathy, we get the idea of the possibility that these children are clones, that there is in fact just one girl and one boy, even though there are several individuals. When they come to represent their thoughts, it seems to be just a boy thought and a girl thought.
And so, to telepathy. And as you will observe in our studio tonight, there are quite a number of people assembled. Right. The first card. E.
In the post-war years, there was a lot of interest in telepathy, both on a popular level and from more surprising quarters.
L.
At the time that Wyndham was writing, there was a big interest in this idea.
G.
Because we're looking at the time after the war, when we were in the Cold War, where people had this idea that maybe it was possible to have psychic spies or people who could go out there and, you know, influence the enemy.
L.
There actually was research commissioned, or at least being funded by the CIA, typically now referred to as the Stargate Project, and that research was looking at the possibility of using remote viewing in a military context.
And it wasn't just the CIA who were interested in telepathy.
There was some research going on behind the Iron Curtain, so the Russians would have been doing some of this research, but in the West, we wouldn't have been that familiar with it. And there was probably the fear that maybe they were ahead of us. So therefore, maybe the Russians are using this kind of technology or this kind of idea, so we should perhaps use it as well.
Wyndham's cuckoos are much more powerful than simple telepaths, and eventually they come into conflict with their neighbours and former parents.
Science fiction has never imagined so strange or terrifying a story as that of the village of Midwich, England, cut off from life as we know it by some...
This conflict takes centre stage in the low-budget movie version of Wyndham's book, made in 1960.
Every woman in the village, children that grew to look like this.
It's a very, very small-scale, low-key, unfussy film. It's that same thing about the children. They're all blonde, and they all speak very correctly, and you know that they're terribly powerful, and that's just a very smart narrative device that works very well visually.
There's nothing you can do to stop us. Leave us alone.
The film treated the Midwich Cuckoos as simply a horror story, but Wyndham's novel is much more discursive. For Wyndham and his mouthpiece, Zellaby, the fascinating question is whether these children might be the precursors of a new, superior type of man.
Evolution of a spirit assumes the eventual development of a greater spirit. Suppose then that this greater spirit, this super spirit, is attempting to make its appearance on the scene. Where is it to dwell?
I often think that philosophy is to science as pornography is to sex. It's cheaper, it's easier, and some people seem to prefer it. Okay, and philosophy of evolution is utterly empty, because if one thing that evolution does, it's not philosophical. It doesn't think, oh God, I'd better evolve a bit, otherwise I'll stagnate. Or we'd better do a bit of natural selection, otherwise in 10 generations we'll go extinct. It's much, much simpler than that. It's simple arithmetic, simple differences in having children.
Whilst Zellaby philosophizes about evolution, a war erupts between the children and the village. When one cuckoo is accidentally run over, the others force the driver to crash. The driver's brother returns, gunning for revenge. They turn his gun on himself. A mob attacks the Grange. Four never return. With the situation spiralling out of control, Zellaby is forced to act. He heads up to the Grange to give them a film show.
It does happen that when you're writing the book, you aren't sure what the ending is going to be. You treat the novel as an adventure, as an exploration. You go on, and when you get to the penultimate chapter, you think, what am I going to do with these little bastards? I know, I'll blow them up.
As he says in his suicide note to his wife, if you want to live in the jungle, you must do as the jungle does.
He kills them as soon as he realises how human they are, which I think is quite an interesting complexity that is left hanging by that strange, brutal ending to the novel.
The Midwich Cuckoos was a powerful enough story to be remade several times for radio and film. For some, it was a Darwinian parable. For some, a satire on the rise of the teenager. For others, a prescient look at surrogate motherhood. For MGM, it was simply a rattling good tale that demanded a sequel. Wyndham wrote 6 chapters of Midwich Maine before giving up. They made it anyway.
It's them or us, for these are the children of the damned.
But for all his success and newfound wealth, Wyndham led a surprisingly unglamorous lifestyle. He had moved into the Pen Club in Bloomsbury in 1925 as an impoverished 20-something, and 30 years later he was still there, sharing a bathroom and eating in the communal dining room.
It was pretty spartan after the war, and the furniture was some of it very run down indeed. Occasionally, I think a bed collapsed. You would never have known from meeting John Harris that he was a very great science fiction writer. He didn't refer to his own books, as far as I recall.
To many of his friends, he seemed like an archetypal bachelor.
John was terribly shy with women. We never thought of him as homosexual or anything. I'm just that he was a detached sort of person.
In fact, he had a romantic side, which came to the fore in his last book of the decade, Trouble with Lichen. Trouble with Lichen tells the story of 2 scientists, Francis Saxover, a tragic widower, and his beautiful young assistant, Diana Brackley.
Diana is initially a young student at the University of Cambridge. She studies biochemistry, and she goes on to work in the laboratory of her mentor, who is running essentially a drug discovery outfit.
Francis Saxover is a benign but rather authoritative feudal lord. He's the brilliant, the maverick scientist, someone who's rather inaccessible emotionally. He doesn't recognise the emotional undertones of the relationship that he has with his younger colleague.
Diana is secretly in love with Francis, but she has 2 problems. Firstly, he's too old for her. And secondly, she is wedded to her career. It all seems insoluble, until they discover the strange truth about lichen. There are thousands of different forms of this unique organism, a combination of a fungus and an alga. It's one of the slowest growing and most resilient life forms on Earth. Francis and Diana are analysing some lichen samples when one night, Diana leaves a saucer of milk out for the laboratory cat. A thunderstorm causes the milk to turn, but it stays fresh in the middle, where a piece of lichen has accidentally fallen in. As they experiment on it, they discover that it has extraordinary powers.
The breakthrough came after 6 years' work by a British drug firm. Out of a piece of fluff...
The 50s was the age of the antibiotic. Penicillin had only just become widely available, and there was a lot of interest in finding similar drugs. As was his wont, Wyndham took a contemporary story and then added a twist.
I think he borrowed a lot from the discovery of penicillin, and in fact the way that the lichenin is discovered is very akin to the way that penicillin was discovered. A speck of mould landed on a plate of bacteria and produced a little zone where all the bacteria were killed, and there are really strong echoes of that in the way that he sets up the discovery.
And the twist was that instead of discovering a new antibiotic, in this tiny piece of lichen, they had discovered the secret of eternal youth. It seemed far from the usual catastrophe. But what if this miraculous discovery had a downside? In the second half, the trouble starts. After several years experimenting on himself, Francis has proved that the lichen also slows down human aging, massively. But he's tormented by the implications of his discovery.
People are going to want this stuff, they're going to want to live longer. There's huge amounts of money in it, there's power associated with having it because it's in short supply, not everybody can have it. There could be civil war, there could be bloodshed, it's going to be politically highly controversial. He knows all that straight away.
In the late 50s, average life expectancy for a male was 66 years, for a woman, 72. Francis realizes that lichen could enable everyone to live for more than 200 years. This would mean marriages that lasted for centuries, dead-end jobs which went on forever, and the end of conventional career structures.
I think it's appropriate that Francis is struggling. It's one of humanity's greatest aspirations, and you know, like anything that suddenly transforms the game plan, you've got to worry about what it's going to change.
Diana also experiments on herself, but she doesn't suffer the pangs of doubt. She instantly sees how lichen could transform women's lives. First things first, she opens Nefertiti, a high-class beauty salon. In addition to all the facials, massages and mud packs, she gives her clients lichen.
It's probably the only honest anti-aging company that's ever existed. She at least gives the women what they want, the ability to remain youthful looking for longer.
But it's not just a cosmetic issue. Diana realizes that her anti-aging compound keeps women fertile for longer, freeing them from the tyranny of the biological clock.
Diana herself, of course, was a scientist, and she readily saw the conflict between becoming a research biochemist and having a family. And Wyndham writes about that, I think, very accurately, that very stark choice of how to spend those critical years.
Wyndham had spent his life surrounded by independent women, from the gun-toting gals of Bedales to the blue stockings of the Pen Club. But he also had a more personal reason for his interest in feminism. Grace Wilson, his secret love.
Grace was English mistress at the Roan School in Greenwich. She was a very elegant person, always impeccably dressed, and a very clubbable sort of person. I think everybody liked Grace. I'm not inferring that people didn't like Harris, but he wasn't the easiest of men to get on with.
Wyndham met and fell in love with Grace Wilson in the early 30s. For many years, they lived in adjoining single rooms at the Pen Club. But marriage was never on the cards.
Grace wanted her career and didn't want to marry. And I felt he felt sort of emotionally... He was very loyal, you see, and he felt emotionally committed to her. He didn't look around for another partner, which he might have done, you see. And so he lost his chance to have a family.
An effective anti-aging drug might have allowed women like Grace to have both a career and a family. But as Wyndham reveals in his book, such a discovery would not be universally popular. When news leaks out, the press goes to town. The unions denounce Lycan as another way of exploiting the working class. The Christians oppose it because it's meddling with nature. The prophets of doom warn of a population explosion. And there are even questions in the House. As the pressure grows, Diana calls a press conference. But she never gets there. It's another shock ending. A scientist gunned down by an unknown assassin because the world wasn't ready for her discovery. But then... 10 pages later, Diana magically reappears. Only to reveal that in fact she had staged her own death. And that now she and Francis can walk off into the sun to plan a very long and happy life together. Wyndham, however, was not quite so happy. He later wrote that he considered trouble with Lycan to be a failure. Instead of seeing the plot implications through, he felt that he had written a lightweight, almost farcical tale.
I think he's doing himself down. I think he saw all the main implications, social, economic, healthcare. I think it's an extraordinarily prescient book.
Although as a story, I'm not wild about Trouble with Lycan. I do respect what Wyndham was trying to do. He wasn't happy with it, but you know, how could you be happy with any attempt to analyse the consequences of such a sweeping and devastating change.
3 years after the book's release, Wyndham tried to write another happy ending, with he and Grace Wilson in the starring roles.
He totally shook us when he came in and told us that he was getting married. We didn't know Grace existed. And we certainly didn't know they'd both been living at the Pen Club for quite a long time. And what they did was they waited until Grace got to retirement age, which was 60, and then they just got married and went to live in the country. But it was a total shock to us.
After a brief wedding at a London registry office, they moved into a modern cottage in Steep.
We went down to visit them in their house. And we said, oh, it looks so lovely. And Harris, I think this is worth saying, because a typical Harris remark, he said, it looks like Harrod's shop window. And indeed, that is what they had done. They had just gone into Harrod's and ordered a bedroom, a second bedroom, a living room, a dining room, a kitchen. And Harrod's just... produced all the furniture, and that was that.
Wyndham was now a stone's throw away from his beloved Bedales and just around the corner from his best friend's house. It all seemed perfect. But there were problems with this ending, too.
It wasn't the idyllic existence that I think he'd hoped for. Grace had never run a house, never done any housework and cooking. was totally undomesticated. He was quite a blue stocking, quite an intellectual person. And that moving to Steep, he was the one, in the end, who suddenly found himself, he had to be the cook, the butler, the parlour maid, the gardener, and the chauffeur. And he was too busy to do his writing.
There were already signs that Wyndham was faltering. In 1958, he'd made an unexpected return to outer space in a collection of stories called The Outward Urge. He was so uncertain of this move that he roped in a mysterious collaborator, Lucas Parks, who was none other than Wyndham himself.
I think I did ask about it sometime later, and he just said, oh, well, it's me, but I don't know, I couldn't understand why.
Wyndham looked around for a real partner for his next book.
He said, Brian, would you like to collaborate on a novel with me? And this could be regarded as quite a favourable opportunity for a young writer. So I said, well, that sounds very interesting. What's it about? Giant spiders, he said. And I didn't feel that was my province.
Wyndham completed this novel, Web, but when he submitted it to his publishers in 1965, it was rejected. A few months later, he had his first heart attack.
He, who'd never done anything of this kind, go out of house with the lawn and got one of the things you had to push. And he wasn't used to physical labour of that kind.
Four years later, John Wyndham Parks Lucas Beynon Harris died after a second heart attack. In his will, he asked for his personal papers to be burnt. He himself was cremated, his ashes scattered on a hill above the village. Today, Wyndham's typewriter resides in air-conditioned splendour in a vault in Liverpool University. But his novels live on. In an era of genetically modified crops, test tube babies, aging populations, and natural disasters, Wyndham's books seem strangely prescient. John Harris is dead. Long live John Wyndham.